Good morning. So I'm Lisa Warren. As Dr. Armstrong mentioned, I'm the rehab manager for occupational therapy, physical therapy, and speech therapy at our center here. I am one of the occupational therapists. So really glad you're here this morning. I'm going to talk to you about rehab services. I'm going to cover all three services in a general manner. I'll talk to you a little bit about insurance. After we have a break, Francis, who is our social worker, is going to talk to you about insurance coverage and those kind of things. But I'll speak to you about coverage with therapy, because we often get that question, does my insurance cover therapy services? So I'll give you an overview of that and a little bit about equipment too, because that's always a question. What will my insurance pay for? Because we know equipment can be expensive. So what can rehab do? We are a part of the team that Dr. Armstrong spoke about. We really believe that it does take an entire village. It takes a team to help you through this process, and we are with you the whole way. With our physical therapy, our occupational therapy, and our speech therapy, we feel like it is never too soon to see us. We would rather see you from the very beginning, and it's also never too late. So if you came to us a little bit later, that's okay also. We just want to see you where you are, find out what your needs are, and what we can help you with. And I'll go into that a little more in just a minute. So this is sort of a busy slide. I'll read to you what it says. So for occupational therapy, they're going to assist you in managing physical, functional, visual, and cognitive changes that may come with some of these atypical Parkinson's diagnoses. They're trained to work from a person-centered perspective to build a supportive social, environmental context to help you manage the symptoms of this disease as well as possible. The OTs can address functional vision. Dr. Armstrong talked about some of the visual changes, perceptual changes that you may experience. They can help you with physical skills, home safety, which is a big concern, community independence, and cognition. They work with you and your family to build the best mix of support to help you throughout your day. OTs and PTs work really closely together to ensure safety. We're looking at it from a different perspective, OT is versus PT, but the main goal is quality of life and keeping you safe and active. For physical therapy, they're going to provide a service that helps to maintain the highest level of function, improving mobility. There's the goal right there. Reducing pain that you may be having from the symptoms, and reduce the likelihood of falls. Dr. Armstrong talked about the difficulty that we have with falls, with postural instability. So that's a big concern. And those falls can lead to other disabilities. Certainly if you fall and you break something, you may be down for the count while you're recovering. Sometimes pneumonia develops while you're less active, and then we have another issue. So certainly we want to keep you off the floor, keep you upright as much as possible, and avoid those falls. The physical therapist is going to examine your medical history like everyone else. They're going to do tests and measures that are going to look at your strength, range of motion, balance. They're going to look at your muscle tone, coordination, posture, and how you function, motor function, and your performance. Our speech therapist, so you may hear them, the SLP is speech language pathology, but you may hear them called speech therapist as well. They're going to work to provide early intervention, which is really key for them. I mentioned in the beginning that it's never too early to see any of us. They really like to see you from the beginning, if at all possible. They want to maintain or increase your communication effectiveness and your swallow function. Again, Dr. Armstrong talked about the swallowing challenges that we have, and aspiration pneumonia is a big concern. So that falls under the realm of the speech language pathologist, and that's something that they want to get a hold of really, really early, get a baseline, and start addressing it from the beginning. They're trained to evaluate individuals for speech, voice, language, swallowing problems. And then again, as I mentioned, the strategies are much more effective if they can get you early. It's easier to try to keep and maintain something than to go back and pick up something that you've lost. So never too early to see us. There's always a lot of education we can provide in the very beginning. If you don't feel like your symptoms are causing a lot of problems, let us just educate you on what to look for and how to hopefully keep the symptoms from causing too many difficulties for you. So what should you do? If you get this diagnosis or your loved one gets one of these atypical diagnoses, what do you do? Exercise regularly, good for all of us, right? Everybody should do that. Participate in meaningful activities. So do what people your age are doing, whatever that might be. Visiting family, traveling, playing bunco, bocce ball, pickleball, whatever it is, do what people your age are doing. And then maintain your current level of socialization as long as possible, okay? There's really some benefit into getting out there and being around people and conversing and being mentally active as well as physically active. So staying engaged in life is really important. And that's the goal of therapy, is to keep a good quality of life and keep you engaged in that life as well as possible. So what symptoms from atypical Parkinson's interfere with those things? Well, all of them. All of the symptoms make those challenging. Certainly if you have balance difficulty and you're falling, then maybe you're not as likely to go to some of these social events. Visual difficulties, that's a really big problem. If you're having difficulty seeing, then you're at a greater risk for falls. It's harder to be out in the community. If you're having some visual difficulties, slowness. A lot of these atypicals cause us to be a little bit slower. Stiffness, muscle stiffness. When your muscles are stiff, it takes a lot more effort to get through your day. It's easier to move a relaxed muscle than it is to move a stiff muscle. So by the end of the day, you have exerted a lot more energy to get through your day than someone without the muscle stiffness has. Just the postural changes, that leads to those falls, makes it difficult for us. It's difficult to get in and out of a chair, in and out of a car with some of these postural changes. Just reaching overhead can be challenging. Blood pressure fluctuations. So if you stand up and your blood pressure drops and you're a little dizzy, a little lightheaded, again, you're at risk for falls, you don't feel well, then those things can make it really challenging to engage in the activities that are meaningful. Cognitive changes. Just difficulty remembering, word-finding difficulties. That happens to all of us. Everyone in here has had that time where that word's on the tip of your tongue and you just can't come up with it. It's more so when there's a lot on our mind. We can't quite come up with it. But with some of these atypical Parkinsonisms, it happens very, very frequently, much more common than just in the average day for the rest of us. So it can be memory, it can be word-finding difficulties, it can be some executive functioning, lots of those cognitive changes, and then it's a bit harder to get out and be social or to interact in the community. Coordination difficulties. So some of these atypicals cause coordination problems. And then sleep problems. Dr. Armstrong had mentioned some of the sleep difficulties that you can have with some of these atypicals. If you don't sleep well, you don't function well the next day. And with some of these sleep problems, the person having the difficulty is unaware of it. It's the partner, it's someone else in the house who knows that they're having difficulty sleeping. But you may get up, that the person with this gets up the next morning and think they slept just fine. But if they're not sleeping well, they're not getting a good night's rest, then you just don't think as clearly. That happens to all of us. So sleep is really, really important. So how do these, yes?
I want to say one good thing to add to that list when it comes to interfering with activities would be swallow.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Because how much of our socialization is around a meal? Good point. Just going out to dinner. So what do these symptoms change? It changes your level of independence. You know, maybe now you need a little more assistance to get through the day. And as I've been talking, it decreases your participation in meaningful tasks. You may be getting a little less likely to go out and do these things, or a little hesitant because things are becoming challenging. And overall, that changes your quality of life. So it's our goal to keep you engaged in life as much as possible, safely engaged in life, and maintaining as much quality of life as possible. So your occupational therapist, your physical therapist, and your speech pathologist are going to work together on all of those symptoms to try to maintain a good quality of life. So sometimes the way we did things before isn't necessarily safe now. So let's see if we can figure out another way to do it, but to still have those pleasures in life. We don't want you to give up those pleasures, but we may have to figure out a safer way to do them. So let's talk about just some of the visual difficulties. We won't go into all the visual changes. Each of the atypical Parkinson's is a little bit different. But one of them that we see quite often is the difficulty with the up and down movement of the eye. So a little more common in the PSP that Dr. Armstrong spoke about. Lots of the different atypicals can have difficulty bringing the eyes in, which is called convergence, so that inward movement. That's really important for reading. We need both of the eyes to focus on the same word so we can read. If they don't come together, then we see double. And so you can imagine how challenging that is. You're out at a restaurant, you're trying to read a menu, and you can't bring the eyes in. So that can be a difficulty in Parkinson's, just typical Parkinson's as well, but we do see it quite often in atypical Parkinson's. So if your eyes don't, moving your eyes up isn't all that problematic. It's a little bit challenging, but there aren't as many dangers here as there are when, you know, down below us. So as I have here for an example, going downstairs, if you can't move your eyes down to see the stairs, you can imagine how challenging that can be to go down those stairs, or stepping off a curb if you can't look down. So all of you, look at me right now. So keep your eyes on me. While you're looking at me, you can probably tell that there's something on the table below you, right? Without looking down, keep your eyes on me. So if that was a plate of food, you might could see that there was something there, but it wouldn't be very clear what it was. Now, if you had to scoop that up and bring that to your mouth, it's a little more challenging to bring that to your mouth, right? One of the things that you can do to help these folks is bring that plate up into their visual field. Put some books under it, whatever it takes to bring it up so that they can see it. Contrast is really important. I've got that down at the bottom. So if those items on your table there were all beige, while you're looking at me, you wouldn't be able to tell what was what. You might not even be able to see them. So if you do have a loved one who has difficulty with that downward gaze, who has PSP, make sure that if they have a dark table, that your plates are a light color. You know, give them some contrast that's going to make those things stand out so they can see them more easily. And then certainly building them up and bring them into their line of sight. Reading, same thing. You know, we typically hold our books down, bifocals. You're looking down through the bottom of them, right, to read. So they'll need to bring those up into their visual field if reading is something they enjoy. Fortunately, nowadays there's a lot of audiobooks also. So if they just enjoy books in general, so maybe you can do the tablets, we'll do audiobooks. The library still have books on tape, those kind of things that you can get. Don't give up pleasures, let's just figure out how to do them, okay? Safely. So balance, this is a biggie. And it affects each of the atypical Parkinsonisms a little bit differently. The physical therapist is gonna look at the gait and the balance and assess the need for an assistive device. It may be a cane, it may be a walker, it may be a wheelchair. We do have a wheelchair clinic here at UF Health. Most of the larger cities have places where you can go and get a wheelchair assessment. Some therapists can do it in the home as well. So there are multiple ways for you to get a customized wheelchair if that's what's needed. With falling backwards is more problematic in PSP. Doesn't mean you can't fall backwards with some of the other atypicals. But some of the strategies that our therapists will use for those who fall backwards is if you have a walker, is making the walker too low. Now that brings your weight forward. Because with PSP, since we tend to go back, our posture is very erect in that, and we go backwards, bringing them forward. Now they're a little less likely to fall backwards. That's not the case with everyone. Some people fall forward all the time. But that's just one of the strategies. So the therapist is going to look at your posture and how you're walking and if you need assistive devices. And if so, how do we need to adjust those to keep you safe? Bending forward to stand up, just getting out of the chair sometimes. Often our feet get wide apart and in front of us, and that's almost impossible to stand up when your feet are forward. So working to get your feet behind you, teaching the caregivers how to cue the person who's having difficulty on how to stand up. Grab bars around the toilet, just having something to hold on to, whether it's a counter right next to the toilet or a grab bar, I can make all the difference in the world in sitting and standing from the toilet. There's some really simple solutions to that too. If you you don't have to drill into the wall or find a stud to put a grab bar around a toilet, there are some that attach to the toilet that provide armrests. So they're easy, inexpensive solutions to making life a little bit easier. For those who do have a tendency to fall back, you want to make sure your chairs aren't against the wall, because they can often, or will often, hit their head as they fall back into the chair. Our goal is to have them sit nicely with a lot of bend and a lot of flexion, so that doesn't happen. But if that is an issue, pull your chairs away from the wall so they're not hitting their heads. So lots of different things that the therapists are going to work on to make life a little bit easier, a little bit safer, while keeping everyone engaged in life. So here are some of the gait problems that we can face in Parkinson's, but in the atypical Parkinson's also. This poor initiation, the inability to start walking, okay? This can happen in any of the atypicals. You stand up and your brain knows that your balance isn't as good as it used to be. So your brain's very smart. You're going to stand up and it's going to put your weight equally on both feet, which is great for stability, right? If I have 50% on my right foot and 50% on my left foot, I'm as stable as I can be. But that's horrible for me trying to walk. Now I've got half my weight on one foot. I can't advance a foot while I'm standing on it. So that's where you get that poor initiation. They stand up, the weight is equal, they're solid. Now they can't move the foot because they're standing on it. So the therapist will look at, you know, swaying side to side. We have walkers that put a laser on the floor to step on, whatever works for the individual to get them to unload a foot to step forward. Music, metronomes, sometimes just a caregiver's voice, step forward, those kind of things will cue the brain to shift over. But that poor initiation of gait, when they stand up, it's their weight is equal on both feet. So we need to unload so we can step forward. So again, that's something that the therapist is going to assess. And one of those, the one with the picture with the lines on the floor is just that. You know, the patient's able to step on the lines, they're focusing on those lines and they can move forward. With some of the atypicals, it's that automatic sequential movement that becomes challenging. So you haven't thought about walking since you learned how to do it. It's very automatic. And so those automatic movements can become challenging. If we can take it out of the automatic and have you think about it, you'll do better. So cueing, music, swaying, lines on the floor, laser on the floor, whatever it takes. Now, there is a situation where the opposite is true, and that is in one of the PSP forms, we have something we call a rocket sign, and they jump up and take off before their body's ready to. So they're sort of the opposite. They can't stop that automatic movement, and their body isn't prepared for that automatic movement. So the phone rings, somebody rings the doorbell, or they think they need to go to the bathroom, and they jump up and they take off. And so that's really challenging because that filter that stops them and says, wait a minute, I don't move very well. Wait a minute, my balance isn't good. That filter just has a few holes in it and it doesn't stop them. That's really challenging for the caregiver, because we'll have caregivers that'll say, he knows he's not supposed to get up. He'll tell me, I see some people laughing. He can tell me he's not supposed to get up on his own, but he gets up on his own every time. So that's when that filter that stops us just isn't working properly. They need to do something, it's automatic, and they take off, and then unfortunately that leads to a lot of falls. So we have different situations. So this is something the therapist is going to help you figure out, and then how do we deal with that? We have people who can't get up and move automatically, and then we have people who can't avoid moving automatically. So we have to figure out what the situation is and how to best keep you safe and everyone less frustrated, right? So, yes. The freezing of gait is when they're walking and their feet stop. And you can imagine that your body's still going forward. You still have this momentum. So those folks are much more likely to fall forward when the feet stop and the body's going forward. So we have some strategies to sort of unlock this poor initiation, this freezing of gait. And the shuffling is the really small steps. So therefore, again, the therapist will work to see which of the strategies that we have is going to be ideal for you. And it may change over time. It may be, well, used to, I could just tell him, you know, stop, take a breath, and start, and that worked beautifully for years. Now, it's not working anymore. So let's figure out what is going to work. So muscle stiffness, I said you can't, it takes more effort to move through your day with a stiff muscle than it does with a relaxed muscle. So we're going to talk to you about stretching. Regardless of which of the atypical diagnoses you have, stretching is really important. These are just some really simple stretches here. If you like to do yoga, seated yoga, regular yoga, adaptive yoga, fantastic. It doesn't matter how you stretch, you just need to stretch. Now, I will tell you, stretching is going to warm up the muscles, it loosens them up, it makes it easier for you to move temporarily, okay? We still have the problem in the brain that's causing the muscles to get stiff. Stretching isn't going to change that, but it allows you to move easier momentarily. The long-term effect of stretching is that when muscles sit tight, if you never elongate them, if you don't stretch them out, they are going to shorten. And then you just don't have full use of them. So that's what we want to avoid, is the shortening of the muscles. That's the most important part of stretching. It's going to give you the immediate benefit, that's temporary, but the long-term benefit is to maintain that full length of the muscle so that you hopefully always have full use of it. The picture in the top left corner, do that one with me. Just sitting in your chair, put your hands behind your head. I want you to bring your elbows back as far as you can and look up. Hold that and just breathe. This is a great postural stretch. So if you're starting to lean forward, many of us do, we sit at a computer during the day. This stretches those upper chest muscles. Your trunk is elongated. Those muscles between your ribs are spreading out. You can breathe easier, so just relax for me. So throughout the day, what a great stretch to open up the chest. So good for all of us. So stretch out, just an easy postural stretch. You can do it in bed before you get up and just try to get your elbows back on the pillow or back on the bed. Gravity will help you a little bit pull with that. But throughout the day, especially if you have one of those diagnoses that pulls your shoulders forward, or those of us without it who still go forward a little bit, all of us slump from time to time. Stretching will make sure that you're able to get out of it, okay, if we can keep those muscles elongated. We often get asked the question, is massage good? Massage is fantastic. It's temporary. So it's just like the stretching. It's going to warm up the muscles. It's going to loosen them up. And boy, what a great way to loosen up muscles if you like that. But it's temporary. They're going to tighten up again. So we always need to stretch. We need that long-term benefit of full use of the muscle length. So the therapist, the occupational therapist and the physical therapist are going to work with you on transfers. And we transfer throughout the day. We get in and out of a chair, in and out of a car, in and out of the shower or the bathtub, in and out of bed. When your muscles are stiff, these things are a lot harder to do. You lose some of that rotation that we need when we're transferred. It's harder to roll over in bed when you're stiff. So we're going to show you some strategies for breaking that up and making it a little bit easier. Maybe it's equipment. The lady that's getting out of the bed has a bedside rail there to help her roll over and push up. So we're going to assess those things and talk to you about your home and where you are and what's challenging for you, and then try to address those. There are certain devices that can help in the car that you can attach into the frame of the car when the door's open that gives you a little handle to transfer in and out of. There's swivel seats that can go on the seat of the car that can help you turn to get your feet out of the car. There are lots of different things that we can try if these things are challenging for you. So these are all the areas and many, many more that we're going to look at to address transfers, how you move about your home, how you move about the community, because we want to keep you going. We want to keep you active, want to keep you out there doing the things that you enjoy doing. So let's talk about cognition. So thinking, our thinking skills. So with many, many of these atypical diagnoses, we can have difficulty thinking, remembering. So cognition, here are just some of the areas of cognition. It's perceiving information, perceiving your environment, reasoning, evaluating, judging, learning, remembering. These are all part of cognition. You know, I talked about just getting out into the community and how important that is. You are perceiving constantly. Somebody's carrying on a conversation with you. You're thinking about what they're saying. You're interpreting. You're evaluating. And then you're deciding how you're going to respond. So there's a lot that goes on just when you go out to lunch with a friend. and it's all good stuff. So that's what we want to keep. You want to keep it having coffee with the guys or playing bunco with the girls or whatever it might be, because there's conversation, there are things going on that keeps our brain active, and we want to continue that. Memory books are great, so jotting down what was done that day or looking back at pictures from the past and talking about trips and grandkids or kids or whatever you might have that you enjoy looking at. Journaling. Writing is really good for cognition. You can do it on a computer. You can actually handwrite if your writing is still legible, if you can read it later, because that is one of the things that often gets affected with some of these Parkinson's and Parkinsonisms, is that our handwriting gets less pretty as time goes on. Most of us don't write much anymore anyway. But journaling can be really good. Using calendars so you don't forget dates. You don't forget things that are coming up. Write them on a calendar, or if you use your phone for calendar, however you want to do it, write those things down. Using notes, simple instructions. So if someone's having a little difficulty, he can heat his soup in the microwave, but he's forgetting how long to heat it for. So how about a little, maybe an index card that says soup 2 minutes, something like that. So just some really simple reminders. And you may have to change that card because our brains habituate. And you know how if you put a post-it somewhere, after a while you don't even see a post-it. It's been there for 2 weeks, now you don't even notice it. So maybe change the color on the card. Maybe you make a little adaptation to it so now it sticks out to them the next time they pull up to the microwave to put the soup in. So just really simple little notes can be helpful. Word games, word search, crossword puzzles, all of those things that require us to think. Those are fantastic. There's a lot of games on the computer. There's a lot of games on your phone. But there's still the old-fashioned, crossword puzzles and those kind of word search books, too. So whatever you enjoy doing. I have one of the games here that our speech therapists really like is a game called Heads Up. Now, you can get it as a board game, or you can download it on your smartphone. It used to be free. I'm assuming it probably still is. And the way this works, you may have seen this or played this before, is you're given a category. So I have an example here. The category is animals. And so one of you is going to give clues to the other one. So one of you knows what the animal is. The animal is zebra. So I don't know that. I just know the category is animal, but I don't know what animal you're about to describe to me. So you're going to give me clues to help me come up with that word, zebra, okay? So maybe you say to me, I've got some clues up there, black and white stripes. So I've got to go into, first of all, I know it's animals, so I've got to pull out that file in my brain where all my animals are. So I know what category. Now I've got that file drawer out, and then we're going to be talking about animals. And you say black and white. Okay, so now I'm starting to look through those files, and I may say panda, skunk. And then perhaps your next clue is shaped like a horse. So now I'm in the animal file, I'm in the black and white, and now I know it looks like a horse. So then hopefully I can come up with zebra. This is great for word finding difficulties. So one of you gives clues, and the other one is trying to figure out the answer. Okay? You can do it. The board game has a card that the person holds it. You've seen it. Holds up. I would hold it up to my head, and it would say zebra, so you could see it. I wouldn't know what it was. And you would give me all the clues, so I would try to find that. And then you can change it, because the person giving the clues has got to come up with those words and those clues really quickly. So let's play. All right? Our category is movies. Okay? So I'm going to give you some hints, and I want you just to start shouting out first thing that comes to your mind. Okay? So pull out that file drawer, all the movies that you've seen that you know about. And when I give you a clue, start shouting them out. So here's our first hint. Set in the South. Civil War drama. Your filing cabinet works really, really well. Uh-huh, Vivian Leigh, Rhett Butler, and what is it? Gone with the Wind. That's right, very good. All right, let's try another one. That was too easy. All right, category, famous singers. So pull that drawer out. And all the singers that you know. And here we go. Rat Pack! But wait, there are a few of them in the Rat Pack. You gotta make sure you get the right one. Dark hair. I think they all got dark hair, right? Everybody loves them. Dean Martin. Dean Martin. And movies with Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin. Yeah, so you see how it is. So you worries. So great activity to play, just to keep our cognition sharp, just keep us thinking. So swallowing difficulties. So this is something else that our speech therapists, our speech language pathologists are going to look at. We do video fluoroscopies, you may hear it called a modified barium swallow. They'll take you to radiology and basically watch you swallow under x-ray so they can see where the food is going, the solid or the drink, and make sure it's going down the right pipe, if you will, and not into the lungs. Sometimes we hold a little bit, sometimes there's a residual. So they're going to look at all of that. Now you may think, well, he's, you know, my loved one's not coughing, so this isn't a problem. That's not always the case. So you can still get items into your lungs and not cough. So sometimes that reflex doesn't work quite as well as it used to. And you may be getting things into your lungs and just not know it. So it's really important that you see the speech language pathologist early on. And let's get a baseline for how you're swallowing, and then they'll watch you over time. They're going to recommend food textures. If some you do better with some than others, then they'll give you that information. And then maybe positioning. Sometimes just a little different position for the chin, for the head, can make all the difference in the world. So they're going to look at that and give you recommendations. And then swallowing therapy. They can work on your swallow as well. So we want to keep you safe and enjoying life. Now, equipment. So there's just everything in the world out there, and thank goodness for Amazon, because it's a whole lot cheaper than it used to be. So we order a lot of our stuff, and a lot of our patients order things from Amazon. And there I have, from one extreme to the other, the blue shirt, the button, that is a simple button hook. That little device goes through the buttonhole, you grab the button on the other side, and when he pulls his hand back, it's going to pull the button through the hole. That takes all the dexterity, all the fine motor out of buttoning a shirt. So if fine motor's an issue, boy, there's your friend right there. What's important is to keep you doing the task. I'd rather you do it with a button hook than to have your spouse do it for you. Okay, there's still some thinking that has to go into using that button hook. There's no thinking that you have to do if your spouse buttons it for you. So I would rather you do it with a device than to have your spouse do it. The lady up in the corner that's sitting, that's a sock aid. So if you have difficulty bending forward, or if you have those blood pressure fluctuations, we don't always want you reaching down to the floor and coming back up. Okay, you can get dizzy with that, feel lightheaded. The sock aid, if any of you have ever had a hip replacement, you probably have one of these or have seen them. You slide the sock on, you drop it on the floor, stick your foot in, slide it up, socks on. Great, great device. So there's something for just about everything. The seat in the middle is a shower chair. It can go in a tub or it can go in a shower. There are long ones or short ones. You can get them with the back, without, with armrests, without. You can spend a lot of money, you can spend a little money on them. There's all types. The top corner is a tub grab bar. This is one of my favorite things. If you have a bathtub at home that you're using, these grab bars, you can get them for as little as $30. They clamp onto the side, works like a vice grip. You tighten it up on the side of your tub. It has rubber on it so it doesn't scratch your tub. And it gives you a handle for stepping in and out. We have a lot of folks who will put a little slit in the shower curtain and even hold on to it while they're showering through the shower curtain. So it really provides a lot of help for safety with very little expense. You're not having to have someone come in and drill into the tile wall, but it gives you support. And if you're traveling to see the kids and grandkids, stick it in the car, stick it in the trunk with you, and now you have it at the hotel or at someone else's house to step in and out of the bathtub. So one of my favorite things to recommend for those of you who are using a tub. The bottom right is something else that a lot of our folks end up getting. It's an attachable bidet. It goes on your toilet. Again, you can spend as little as you can spend anywhere from $30, I think, to $500 if you want it heated and with a dryer. You can spend quite a bit of money on it. Personal choice, whatever, no judgment. But it certainly can help with hygiene. You know, if you're having difficulty with that, it's not something we like to talk about, but it is something your occupational therapist is going to talk to you about. We want to make sure that that you can take care of that. And so if reaching behind you and doing a really thorough job with that is becoming challenging, there are options. There are ways we can get this done. Okay. Sometimes people will come to us and say after they have a bowel movement, they get in the shower because they can't clean themselves. well, this is a whole lot easier than having to get undressed and shower and dry off and redress. So something this simple might be the answer. So now let's talk about the biggie here, insurance and therapy. So wherever you get your therapy, that clinic should be able to tell you what your coverage is, what any expected co-pays, out-of-pocket expenses are. Okay. Let's just talk about, I've got private insurance listed first. It varies. So private insurance may give us a visit limitation, meaning they may say, and this is very common, you can have 25 visits combined. That means OTPT speech, 25 visits. Typically, they'll give us a calendar year. So, and that's it. Okay, so we have to use them sparingly, and we have to communicate with each other. So what's the most immediate need? Well, right now you're having some trouble swallowing. Let's let speech focus on their area. OT and PT may step back and not see you quite as often. Let's get that addressed. So it's really important that wherever you go, the staff is communicating with each other, regardless of what kind of insurance you have. Quite honestly, you will have a limit. So it is really important that they communicate. We have a very interdisciplinary approach in that we are communicating about you to each other, to the physicians, whoever's involved in your care. So we do know where you are in your visit limit. You may have a duration limit. So we see this sometimes too. Your insurance may say, all right, you can have 6 visits from each discipline, but only until May 1st. And then on May 1st, if you need more, we have to ask for it. We have to present them with the documentation saying you need more, okay? Now this falls upon the clinic to know what you have, what you don't have, and then to educate you too, to tell you why we're dosing the therapy the way we are, that we gotta get in as much as we can because come May 1st, we don't know if we'll get more, or if we have all year, then we want to spread it out and make those 25 visits last from January until December. Okay, those are the private insurances. Medicare, so if you have just straight Medicare, you'll have Medicare cover 80% of your therapy. You'll have 20% copay. If you have a secondary insurance, they should pick up the 20%. Depends on your individual situation. Medicare has a cap on therapy. Okay, the cap, unfortunately, combines physical therapy and speech therapy together. They have to share visits. We think about it as a pot of money. Medicare gives you $2,010 to spend in therapy per calendar year, January 1st to December 31st, okay? PT and speech have to share that. That's gonna get you, depends on the contract, but that'll get you anywhere from 15 to 20 visits maybe of therapy, okay? Occupational therapy has their own cap of $2,010, okay? OT has their own separate pot of money, if you will. PT and speech have to share. Now, here's the thing. With progressive illnesses, Medicare does allow us to ask for that a second cap. So we can go into a second pot with proper documentation, and your therapist should know how to document to ask for that second pot of money, if you will, or to go beyond the cap. And it's a little bit easier to explain that with these progressive illnesses. It would be harder to explain that with an ankle sprain, right? You have an acute injury that Medicare expects recovery and move on. They wouldn't expect a continuation in you going into the second pot of money or that second set of visits, okay? But with something that is progressing and things are changing, we're able to document and bill to notify Medicare, hey, we know we've reached the first cap, but this is medically necessary and here's what we're doing. Okay? So PT and speech have to share with regular Medicare. OT has a separate pot and the limits are, you know, somewhere less than 20 visits per year for each pot. So if your therapist will spread it out, you know, you could get a couple of visits each month throughout the year. And that's really what we recommend. We don't recommend burst treatments like you may get for a hip fracture, some orthopedic issue. We recommend these be spread out because you are changing, slowly changing, hopefully, but you're changing over time and we want to stay on top of it. We'd rather be proactive than reactive. If you have a Medicare replacement or a managed care policy, they're all different. So we may only get to evaluate you and then ask them for visits, and they'll either give us a number of visits, they may give us a duration, they may give us both. So each of the Medicare replacement policies is a little bit different. But wherever you get your therapy, they should be able to tell you what your limitations are, what Medicare will provide, or insurance. And Frances is going to talk a little more about insurance coverage when she talks later. One more thing I want to talk to you about is outpatient therapy versus home health therapy. So there are two types of therapy outside of being in the hospital. There are pros and cons to both. And they're appropriate at different times throughout your lifetime based on what you're going through. Home health therapy has very specific guidelines for homebound status. It has to be really taxing for the patient to leave the home. Now, that can be mentally taxing. It doesn't have to just be physical. But it has to be challenging to leave the home. And unfortunately, it doesn't matter so much about how hard it is on the caregiver. It's all about the patient with Medicare. So it's really unfortunate. Your car doesn't work well. It's too far to get to a clinic. Doesn't, unfortunately, concern them quite as much. But if it requires quite a bit of an effort to get out of the home, physically or mentally, then that may very well qualify you for a homebound status, which means therapists would then come to the home. Nursing care can come to the home, some home health aid, which would help with some of those activities of daily living. But here's a caveat, you can't get both at the same time. So if you're going to an outpatient clinic for therapy, you can't also get home health. That's double dipping, and that can't be done. So one or the other, if you meet the homebound status, you know, take advantage of it. It's hard for them to continue for a long period of time. I believe it's every 60 days they have to get recertified and improve their need to be in there. And so that becomes challenging over time for them. So they may come in for 8 weeks or so, and then they have to discharge. Just depends on what's going on. Outpatient, our restrictions aren't nearly as stringent. So we can you know, stretch our visits out a little bit easier. But there's a time that one's more appropriate than the other. Certainly in the outpatient clinic, we may have more equipment, you know, to offer some different things that we can work on. Your home health therapist is limited to what they get in the car or what you have in your home. But I will tell you, if you are experiencing some cognitive changes, some dementia, just having some difficulty with new learning, the home is the best place. Because nothing makes more sense than learning it in your environment. Because we can take you into the clinic bathroom and show you how to get on and off our toilet 15 times. But at home, your toilet height may be different, your approach to the toilet is different, your lighting, the coloring, everything changes. So just because you can do it in our bathroom doesn't necessarily mean you can do it at home. So if you are having some difficulty just remembering things, like I said, dementia, just some memory problems, or new learning is a little more challenging, the home is a great environment to work on some of those things.